Turned in. They're going to deliver it to the church for us. Bailey, is it Ruby Farms?
It's Ruby Branch Farms.
Ruby Branch Farms. According to Bailey, they're the best moms on this side of Mississippi. So you want some? They are $15 a piece, and we've got to get those paid for before they get here. So you can pay us in the next couple weeks. But there's order forms in the back. The youth are also going to have some order forms. I set a goal of $75 for us. That'll profit the youth account about $500 something. So if we do 75, if this goes well and it's something we can do next year, we can up that goal. So we'll just see how it goes. But our goal this year is going to be 75, and I'll try to keep you guys updated as far as where we are. This will be in the back.
All right, anything else?
Somebody left the glass a little bit.
Okay.
Somebody left the glasses
over here, maybe from this class. If you're missing your reading glasses,
Hopefully they're just reading glasses. Oh, you made it a week without your glasses. That's good. You probably got better. So anyway, there's glasses over here. If you've left them. Is that it? Anything? All right. Ushers. If you guys want to come on up. Pat, you might say the prayer,
bro. Father, thank you for the opportunity to be in your house again this morning. Lord, we just pray your blessings on the offering that's been able to be collected. Lord, we pray we'd give that with a charitable heart, Father, in a giving spirit that would be, these things would be blessed in a way that would build your kingdom. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lord.
You want to sing a song without the words?
Yeah.
I'll get you. Let me get there. And now I knew what you were talking about. Went to my heart and to my heart. I was a broken man, but I found you're my healer, my redeemer, Jesus. That's who you are. You brought me blessings out of a tragedy. You turned my old song into a symphony. And with your spirit living inside of me, I'm a new creation. From my head into my heart. When I was broken at the bottom, I found you're my healer, my redeemer, Jesus. That's who you are. You brought me blessings out of a tragedy. You turned my old song into a symphony. And with your spirit, I need you.
refuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace.
Singing, it's about our worship to you, and we thank you so much for our opportunity. Lord, we thank you for technology, but we also know that it's not perfect, and we're not perfect, and we thank you for that. We know that you are perfect, and you give us a Savior that hopefully something that we say, that we sing, will just show that to a lost and dying world. So open our hearts right now. Let us just be receptive to the word that Tommy's going to bring to us. We know it's powerful and it can change lives, and we thank you for it. Forgive me where I fail you, and then we pray. Amen. You can be seated. Amen.
Children's Church, you can be
together and just have a time of worship, time of fellowship, and a time to just praise the Lord. You know, maybe the Lord's done something in your life this week that you'd like to share. Anything? Has God blessed you in some way this week?
Yes. Right here.
Would anybody like to share it? What's the Lord done for you?
I'd like to thank the Lord for his many blessings. Praise his name. And I've got family that I'd love to see. Be a part of the house of God. And I just pray and thank everybody for all their prayers. But mostly I want you to pray for the family members that's not here that I'd love to see in church.
Amen. Amen. That's a need. I'd say everybody in here's got.
That's right.
You know, there's no doubt in my mind that everyone here has a loved one. Family member, friend, somebody that's lost. You know, and that's something we need to pray about. We need to pray for those that don't know Jesus, that's away, or maybe at one time they knew and they're in that backslidden state.
I want to thank everybody for the prayers, phone calls. I didn't know whether I'd be here today or not.
It's a blessing to see you out there.
It's pretty tough week.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Well, I got lots of calls for and wife.
Yes, Anybody else? If not, if you would turn with me this morning to Luke chapter 14, Luke chapter 14, beginning in verse 15. You know, we're going to talk about, it's almost supper time. Y'all like supper time? I like supper time. Yeah, I really do. And I remember when I was a kid, supper time, you know, it was a very special time. As a child growing up, as I said, it was that time when I'd been at school all day, got home, and, you know, hadn't had nothing to eat since probably 10:30, 11 o'clock. And then, you know, mom and dad, usually they didn't get home till 4 or 5, somewhere around there. But we always had supper together. You know, it was a time that we came together, we sat down and had a meal. The TV was turned off. The cares of the world were kind of outside, unless daddy was having a bad day at work or something like that. It was usually pretty quiet, pretty peaceful. And, you know, I used to think about it, how much I enjoyed it then, but it was more about the food. I loved to eat. Now, when I look back, it was that time together, you know, as a family. As I said, that time to come together and to share with one another the experiences of the day, the things that had taken place. Do you know, what we're going to talk about today is another great supper that's coming. You know, a great supper that we need to keep in mind and we need to prepare for. Beginning there in verse 15, it says, "Now when one of those who sat at the table with him heard these things, he said to him, 'Blessed is he who shall eat bread in the kingdom of God.' Then he said to him, 'A certain man gave a great supper and invited many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to those who were invited, "Come, for all things are now ready." But they all with one accord began to make excuses. The first said to him, "I have bought a piece of ground, and I must go and see it. I ask you to have me excused." And another one said, "I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm going to test them. I ask you to have me excused." And still another said, "I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come." So that servant came and reported these things to his master. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to the servant, "Go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city and bring in here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind." And the servant said, "Master, it is done as you commanded, and still there is room." Then the master said to the servant, "Go into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say to you that none of those men who were invited shall taste of my supper." Let us pray. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we just humbly bow and come before you this morning once again. Father, I pray that every song that has been sung, every prayer that has been offered, dear God, has been pleasing to you. And Father God, I ask, dear God, that as we have read through your word, that you would just begin to speak, dear God, that you begin to touch hearts and souls and lives, dear God, and begin to rekindle the fire, dear God, that maybe has gotten a little dim or a little weak. Dear God, and I pray that if there's any here this morning, dear God, that don't know your saving grace, that today would be that day before it's everlasting too late. Father, give us the words that we need from this message, dear God. Move me out of the way, because if it's completely from me, then it's not worth anything, dear God. It needs to be from you. And Father, we just give you the praise and the glory for everything. For it's in Jesus' holy name we ask this. Amen. You know, as we look at this, there's some things that are going on. Now, it says that when this man heard Jesus speaking about what to do if you're invited to a supper, right? You know, when we look back, this whole section is parables. This whole chapter is parables, and on over into the other chapter. And Jesus had given them a parable about taking the lowly place. And what he was doing was he'd been invited to one of the Pharisees' houses to come and to break bread. You know, and Jesus was there to break bread that morning or that afternoon or whatever time it may have been. And there was another man there, and he was talking. Now, Jesus had told him, said, now, when you come into a place to eat, don't come in and take the high position. In other words, don't come in and sit down at the head of the table because you might get embarrassed. He said, it's always best to take that lowly seat back in the back and, you know, and let the host come in and say, you know, good friend, I have a better seat for you here. Come up front. Now, when I look back here, there's a lot of people that's sitting in the back. It's okay. Good friends, come on up front. It's good to do that. We can do that in the house, Lord. We can come on up front and sit and be in God's presence. You know, but when Jesus was talking about this and sharing that parable, in verse 14 he says, and you be blessed because they cannot repay you, for you shall be repaid at the resurrection of the just. He was talking to them about who all we invite. You know, when we think about it and we have a dinner or something like that, or we have something, a big event going on in our house, we'll invite those that are, you know, our friends, you know, our close friends, those people. We'll invite maybe, you know, if it's an influential party, we'll invite those that has influence. But Jesus was saying, you know, why are you inviting these folks? They're the ones that can repay you. You know, they have the means to do that. He said, why are you not going out and inviting those that are maimed and lame and blind? Those that are broken. You know, sometimes we'll invite people to come to church with us, and a lot of times it may be that they already go to another church. Do we ever do that? We do, don't we? And it may be because there's a special event or something going on and we just want them to be a part of it. But what about the ones that are broken? The ones that can't care for themselves. The ones that are downtrodden and broken down and beat down. The ones that can't stand on their own. The ones that are blind. That don't see the spiritual truth of the things that are going on. You know, I can remember at one time I was in a church and I heard someone say, they were talking about the bus kids. The bus kids, the kids that come in on the buses. When they come in here, oh, they just don't know how to act. They tear up everything and it's just terrible. They get dirty tracks all over everything. And they were upset about that. But you know, a child that's never been in a church don't know how to act.
That's right.
And there's adults that maybe have never set foot in the door of the church, and they don't know how to act. But should we exclude them? We should let them be a part, right? We should come along beside them and love on them and show them that, hey, there's a better way. And his name is Jesus. He's the way to true joy and true happiness. You know, we look to the things of this world and we're always looking for something that's going to make us happy, something that's going to please us for this day or for the next day. But it's always fleeting. It's not going to stick around with us. It's going to go away and we're going to be sad. But the one that won't leave us, that won't abandon us, that don't leave us feeling broken is Jesus Christ. He's the one that's there with us in the darkest times of our life. When we think that, oh, there's nobody here. Nobody cares about me. Jesus is there and he's saying, I do care. I love you. And I want you to be a part of my family. And that's that supper invitation that I was talking about. Because there's a great supper that's coming someday. It's going to be a great party. But you know, the invitations are being sent out right now. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I'm giving you the invitation right now because he told his servants to go out and to give the invitations. And you know, he had sent that invitation out for this great meal to the ones that he knew. He had asked them, he said, you know, come and dine. And then we start hearing all these excuses, and it's the same excuses that the world uses today. Nothing has changed. You know, the one guy says, you know, I bought land and I've got to go see it. Now, I don't know about you, and I'm not the smartest fella in the room, but if I'm going to buy a piece of property, I'm going to go look at it before I put my name on it. Amen? I don't care if it's a piece of land, a house, or whatever it is. I want to make sure what shape, what condition it's in. Now, the other guy, when you know it was time for that invitation, he said, you know, I bought 5 yoke of oxen. Now, men, have you ever bought a tractor and not at least sat on it? That's the same difference here. This man had bought 5 yoke of oxen. He says, I've got to go prove these oxen out. I've got to see what they can do. I've got to see if they can work. In other words, he was taking his work and putting it before everything else. And we tend to do that sometimes, don't we? We'll say, you know, I've got to work. You know, I'm sorry, preacher. Won't be there on Sunday. We got overtime. I understand. I worked in the public sector for a long time. And sometimes you get forced. And they say, you got to be here if you want to have a job. I understand that. But a lot of times what they will then do, what the world will then do, they'll then entice you with double time. Or double time and a half sometimes. Oh, we need you to work on Sunday, but I tell you what you're going to do. If you come in, we're going to pay you 2.5 times more than what you normally make. And I've seen it more than one time. A lot of those guys that went in to make 2.5 times more than what they normally would make through the week, they would work it, and then Monday morning they'd call out and say, I can't make it in. I've had vision problems. I don't see myself being there. But we can turn down and say, we're not going to serve the Lord. You know, the money is important, and I understand that. We've got to make a living. We feel like that's the things that we need to do as husbands, as men. We've got to take care of our family. And I'll tell you about another man that he got so involved with the things of trying to make the living, trying to make the next step, that he missed out on his family growing up. He missed out on his son and his daughter. Because he was either working or he was in school. And there's consequences for that. When they get to a certain point, it's like, Daddy, he's not here. He's at work. And you think, well, I'm doing it because I want to do good for my family. I want them to have the things that I never had. I want them to have that big house. Why? So when you die, they can fight over it? Am I right? If I'm lying, if I'm getting out of line here, let me know. Or you want to build that bank account for them, right? You want to put them through college. That's a good goal. But I tell you what, a lot of times you appreciate that education more if you had to pay for it yourself. Amen. Then mom and daddy giving it to you because you'll go there and, you know, it's a party for the next 4 years. Woohoo! I'm on my own. But when you have to, you pay for it yourself, rather through military service, scholarships, or actually working a job to put yourself through school, you appreciate it a lot more. You know, and then there's this other guy, he said, well, you know, I've gotten married. And he was worse than the other two because he didn't even say, please excuse me. He says, I ain't coming. I'm married. You know, this man, he didn't even ask to be excused. He put family duties in front of the duties of his faith. Sounds reasonable, doesn't it? But as a husband, as a father, as a wife, as a mother, The greatest duty you have to your children is to raise them in church, to know who Jesus Christ is, to raise them in the faith. Because if they get that right, it's a good chance they're going to be able to put the other things in life in the proper perspective and proper order. Now, see, we're to take care of family, those family duties, but God does not give conflicting duties. He's not going to tell you to do something this way and then say, okay, well, I'm going to give you this duty, but, you know, I'm going to give you this duty over here as well, and they work against each other. That's not what's going on here. You know, God, when he puts things in order, and we miss that at some time. You know, and he goes on, and as he's talking to him, he tells him, he says, now it's time. The feast is ready. And then as that invitation is going out and he's getting all these excuses back, he says, what's happened? Nobody's wanting to show up. So he tells his servants, by the way, that's the church, go out into the highways and hedges. Go to the cities. Go and compel them to come in. And that doesn't mean take your Bible out there and hit them over the head with it. That's not what he's saying when he's saying compel them. He's telling them, compel them to come in by how you live your life, by what you show is important, by the things that you say and do for others, that you reach out and you minister to those that are broken and downcast and can't do for themselves. Compel them to come in. Make it when they see you in your life and what God is doing through you and with you that they want to be a part of it. Are we doing that, church? It's not enough to go out and to say you've got to come in or else. We've got to love on them. We've got to care for them. When we're looking at this, he says, none of these men who have tasted or who were invited shall ever taste of my supper. He even went back and he said, you know, those three that were invited, they didn't want to come. They made excuses. He said, they're not going to get another invitation. And you know, we think that when we're growing up in life or when we're in church, we think that at some point in time, you know, I want to come to Jesus Christ, but I don't want to now because I'm young. I've got so much of my life ahead of me. I've got time. But that's not always true. We had a young girl in our family. She's 19 years old. And she left home, joined the military, and she ended up getting out because of the stress that the military life or military duties put on her body and was breaking her legs and stuff down, and she couldn't handle it, so they put her out of the military. And she came home for a little while and she decided, well, I'm going to go back over here to Oklahoma where I've got friends and people that they're getting ready to graduate basic training. She said, I'm going to start my life over there. Even though I'm not going to be in the military, I'm going to go there and I'm going to have a life there. And she was gone for about 2 or 3 weeks. Well, it was a little longer than that. It was Christmas Day that she left. We got the call on Martin Luther King Day that week. We were in Honduras on a mission trip. And I got a call from Susie. She said, can you come home? She said, Haley got killed in a car wreck. So even though you think you're young and you got time, you may not.
Amen. That's right.
We're not promised tomorrow. We're not promised there will be another opportunity for you to repent and to come to know Jesus Christ. Today is that opportunity. We may be, you know, in that backslidden state. We keep saying, Lord, I'm trying to, but I keep putting it off, and I just don't know what to do, and I'm scared, dear God, because I know that if I go up to the altar and try to repent and return to you and renew my faith, somebody's going to talk about me. I'm going to tell you right now, don't worry about what somebody's going to say about you.
Right.
Worry about what Jesus Christ
Amen.
Said, what he thinks. He said, go in. Jesus, the man, he tells him, he said, go out. Go out to the poor. Go out to those that are lost in sin. Those that are spiritually broken. You know, when we think about the poor, we look at the financial side of life, but there's a spiritual poorness that is out there in this world. And I tell you what, right now this whole nation is spiritually bankrupt.
Amen.
We're so lost in the sins and the struggles of this world and what we think is going to make us happy that we forget that it's Jesus Christ that we need. And we're poor and we're broken down. And we think, you know, there's the maimed and the lame. You know, when we look at this, see, sin keeps us from serving God as we should. When it's talking about the maimed and the lame, it's talking about those that are physically broken down. They can't minister to those that are in need, that are broken and they're hurting and they're in pain. And they can't even make it to this altar by themselves because they're hurting so bad. It says we need to go out and compel them to come in. And if you need a helping hand up here this morning, give me a call. I'll come up and walk with us out with you. Or somebody back there with you will walk this aisle with you and help you. Not just because of the physical, but because of the spiritual pain. We can be crippled. And it keeps us from doing what it is that God would have us to do. He also goes on to tell us there, he says, go out into the streets and the lanes, the highways and the hedges, and we are to go to where the spiritually destitute are. Are we doing that? As the church, are we going to where the spiritually destitute are? You know, when we think about that, it doesn't mean just going to a place like Honduras. It doesn't mean just going to a place like, you know, China. It doesn't mean going to a place like Niger, Africa. It means going out those doors because I tell you, as I said earlier, there's those that are spiritually destitute and broken here.
That's right.
And we need to minister to them. If you think about it, you might be able to think of one family that's hurting right now. It's dealing with some kind of pain and anguish in their life. Dad's an alcoholic. He's abusive. Or mom, she's struggling with her next fix. You can minister to those people. You can pray for them. You can go to them. You can love them. You can hug on them. You can tell them that Jesus Christ loves you. As they go on, he says, the servant comes back and he says, Master, it is done as you commanded. And there's still room. Look around you this morning. How many empty seats you see? There's still room. You know, there was a song that I used to hear the Rippies sing. Come on in, there's still room in the family. Come on in, there's still rest for the weary soul. Come on in, feel the joy that awaits you. Come on in, God bless you. God,
make yourself at home.
Make yourself at home. God bless your soul. And that's the way it is here for us. We've got room, people. We need to be about the Father's business. We need to be going out and compelling those to come in. And as I said, compel them to come in because of the love that's in this house this morning. As Sister Harper said, there's people that are lost in my family. There's people that's lost in your family. There's neighbors that are hurting this morning that need a place to come and to feel loved and appreciated and needed. It's up to you. It's up to me. It's up to us to be the hands and feet of Christ and to go and minister to the lost and the needy. He told him, he said, see, that invitation, it will be extended until the house is full. That's what was being said there. That my house may be filled. Go. That invitation is open until the house is filled. At some point, he's going to say to him, son, it's time. It's time to go get my children and bring them home. The house is full. Go get them. Are you going to be ready? Today's the day to get it right. Today's the day to come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you don't know Him. Today's the day, if you're in that backslidden state, it's time to come home. It's time to get it right. He's waiting on you. And we'll wait on you too. We'll be at this altar waiting for you. We get a song of invitation. We got somebody this morning with a song. If you would please stand with your feet. Don't wait. And while they're getting the song together, if you need to come on down this altar and pray, come on down. I'll meet you here. There's other people that's going to meet you here, and we're going to pray with you. And we're going to pray for you. But don't put it off. You might not get another chance.
When the best of me is barely breathing, when I'm not somebody, I believe in, hold on. Miss the light that night has stolen.
just so thankful. Just so thankful for this church. Thankful for the blessings that you gave me last week. I'm not used to a fuss being made over my birthday. And I have been working on eating all those Reese's peanut butter cups. I feel like maybe I've gained a little bit of weight. My sugar's through the roof. But it's been appreciated. Maybe the Lord's dealing with you about something. I know we had that time to testify this morning before church. Maybe he's done something to you. Maybe he spoke to you this morning. And you need to share something. What's on your mind? What is God pressing upon your heart?
Really enjoyed the message for Tommy. So long ago, all this study, such good class, you know. We've all got a choice right now. There's going to come time.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen. Anyone else?
Brother, I've been reading a little book that's just the cycle of victorious living. And in this book, there was a paragraph or two. This granddaughter came. The mother was giving the grandmother some breakfast. The grandmother was in bed gasping because she had severe asthma. And the daughter said, "Grandma, why don't you save your breath? Why are you praising the Lord all the time and saying glory, hallelujah?" Grandma said, "I'm praising the Lord for who he is."
Amen.
"Not for where I am."
That's right.
Amen.
And that really spoke to my heart. I know a lot of us can have some real trials that just don't seem to go away. And we fight to try to make it. So I bowed my head at the table. I said, "Jesus, why don't you answer my prayer? I've been praying about something for so long. Where are you? You speak to me." And then I saw something. I heard it. He said, "Rejoice. Now get up and go get that little book and read those chapters again." It was just very powerful. You know, it's sometimes easy to praise the Lord, say, "Praise the Lord." But it's another thing to rejoice when everything seems to be against you and you can't seem that you're gonna make it through. Just rejoice. And I've been saying, "Jesus, I need to learn that. I need to learn how to rejoice. And whatever I'm going through or whatever anyone else is going through, it's for you too. If you can't say, praise the Lord for this beautiful day, well then just rejoice, Jesus, I'm rejoicing because you are the one. And I'm trusting you, period."
Amen. Amen.
All right, follow that, Eddie. I am going to say it. I really enjoyed your message. Morning, Brother Tommy, like what she said, it's kind of along the same lines as what we just studied in Daniel. Before anybody that wants to come to Sunday school, we're fixing to start on the revelation of Jesus Christ next week. What a great book that is. We've been having a real good study. We've got a really good teacher explaining stuff to us. And I'm not talking about me. And Brother Haggall in the past, everybody's welcome.
It's almost supper time.
Right.
I bet they've got the table set on there.
Brother Tom, I'd like to ask the church to remember my brother Joel and Barbara. I don't know why they're not here this morning, but she's having some trouble with her legs. She's having pain, real severe pain going down her legs. Remember her and Joe too.
For all of us, just remember, in our darkest hour, Jesus is still the light of the world.
And all of you, I know all of you, Brother Rob, his mother-in-law was the one that they called in for hospice in there. So just remember that fact.
Anyone else? Don't carry it with you. If the Lord's putting it on your heart, you better share it. You're going to be miserable all week.
Brother Tommy, I appreciate what you said about there's always room because we've accepted empty pews for a long time.
It's
time for us to fill them.
That's right.
Amen.
We need to be praying that way.
Yeah.
I'd like to see it so full that we have to raise the window. Those windows don't raise, though, do they? We'll have to do something else. We'll do something else. Anyone else? Any announcements?
Wednesday night, ladies' prayer group. Everyone's welcome. Afterwards, we do a little Bible study if there's any time left. We're working on Sarah. Love to have anybody. Wednesday at 6 o'clock.
I got something. Everybody sit down for just a second. We're going to consider ourselves in business order. Open the doors of the church for Brother Tommy and Sister Susie to come in and become part of a membership of our church. As we fill these pews, hopefully we'll have more and more members to come in our church as well. That's what we're praying for. But at this time, Brother Tommy and Sister Susie will come up. We'll consider ourselves in business order. I got a couple questions for you. One, that you know at one point you were lost and God saved your soul and you're saved and then baptized it with his name. Second, that you know, by being a member of the church, you're going to, you know, pledge to the church that you're going to do everything you can to be here, be at work for the church.
I do.
That's all the questions I have. Anybody else have any questions? See, I nominate that they become members of our church. Second up. Everybody raise, stand up, say amen.
Amen.
Any opposed? Congratulations. We'll have a round of fellowship. Welcome into the church. And then we'll have a close of prayer for the meal. So, Brother Wayne, will you have a close of prayer?
Our dear great most heavenly Father, this morning, we love you so much, Lord, for this good service that you sent Brother Tommy to take us for, Lord, so we can live a better Christian life for you each day. Thank you for another day of life, Lord, and this meal we're about to have, Lord, bless over it. And the ones who prepared it for us, Lord, and give us strength and nourish for our bodies. Lord, as we said earlier, we want to continue to remember the sick in the community, the needy, God, throughout the world, Lord, and the ones who face death, Lord. Just comfort them, Lord, and families. Be with them, lift them up, God. There again, we love you more each day, Lord. We give you praise for everything. We want to tell you, Lord, we want to won't ever forget what you have done for each one of us, what you're doing now, God, and what you can do. We give you praise for it all. In your name we pray. Amen.